What is head-end dual deployment, and how do you set it up, and when would you use it in your model rockets? That's what we're going to cover in this video.
Welcome to Advanced Construction Videos, where we show you how to tackle rocketry building techniques and more. On our website, we sell kits, motors, building supplies, and electronics. So come and learn, shop, build, and fly when you visit us at ApogeeRockets.com.
Hi, I'm Tim Van Milligan from Apogee Components. Today we're going to cover the fascinating topic of head-end dual deployment. So first of all, what is dual deployment? Over here I've got a rocket called Mako, and we set this one up for dual deployment. And in dual deployment, we want to eject two parachutes at different times in the flight. First, we're going to eject a small parachute right at apogee, which is the highest point in the flight. And it's a small parachute, so the rocket's going to come flying down really fast. And the purpose of this is so that it doesn't drift very far. But it's coming down too fast to land safely. So at a lower altitude, we're going to eject a big parachute to slow it down for the final landing. So the overall purpose is to get the rocket to land close to the launch pad so that you don't have to walk very far to get it, and you have less chance of losing your rocket. It's used a lot in high power, but it can be used in small rockets as well. We do have a small rocket we call the Katana Junior, which is great for learning dual deployment. But this one here is kind of a mid-power rocket, and it also is set up for dual deployment. And we have in the middle the electronics bay. And so this is the electronics bay, and if you open it up, this is where you would store the electronics that controls the process, because that second parachute that is deployed at a lower altitude has to be controlled by electronics. And you'd have an eBay, something like this, that would have electronics in it, and it would fire off deployment charges to push that second parachute out. So traditionally, the electronics bay is placed in the middle of the rocket, so you can have the parachutes that are separate. You put the small one in the back, and the reason for that is so that you can use the rocket motor's ejection charge as a backup to the apogee charge that is in the eBay. So that's why the small one is typically always in the back, and it leaves the bigger one up in the front. Sometimes your rocket is not configured correctly where you can put the electronics bay in the middle, and you'd like to move it towards the front. And this would be called head end dual deployment because it's at the head of the rocket. So what we want to do, we want to put that electronics bay up near the nose cone, but because of the shoulders on it, it's going to fear with the shoulder on the nose cone. So is there a way to move this even further forward? And that's what we're going to do with head end dual deployment. Now there's other options as well. You can set it up to use something called a chute release, which the deployment of the lower parachute by keeping that parachute reefed up, but it's out in the air already. And then once it gets to a lower altitude, it just unfurls that parachute. But you do have that parachute flapping around in the wind as the rocket's coming down. So that is an option if you want to go that route, but some people do want to put this into the nose cone. Now you can do it. The concept came about a long time ago with rockets that were made out of fiberglass. In a fiberglass kit, you have the nose cone and you have the shoulder that was separated. And somebody got the brilliant idea is, look how big this is. Let's put the electronics in there. And since this is not glued in, we can have our parachute up here in the front. And it's got a lot of volume in there, so there's plenty of room for a parachute. You cap it off with two bulkheads, put the electronics in there, so it operates just like a dual deployment. And this is the first head-end dual deployment rocket, probably was fiberglass. But what if your nose cone is plastic? So here I have the plastic nose cone for like the Invicta. And this question comes up a lot in the Invicta rocket. Because this is a two-stage rocket, it goes really high. And people want to do dual deployment in this rocket. The electronics bay is in the middle, and it's in the middle for a reason, because we need to use the electronics to ignite the motor in the upper stage. But can you put a separate electronics bay up in the nose cone? And that's what we're going to do. So what we're going to do is take the nose cone, cut off the back end, cut the shoulder off, and can we put the electronics bay into here like we did with the fiberglass? And actually, we can. As you can see, this does fit in, and then there's still a lot of room left over for the parachute inside. But the problem is now we don't have a way to keep the nose cone attached, so when the ejection charge goes off and pulls the parachute out, this is going to go separate. So we need to tie this to the body of the rocket. So we're going to take our shock cord, and I'll show you what my plan is here. I'm going to take the fix-it epoxy clay, and I am going to bond the shock cord into the nose cone so I have an anchor point. Now, you can do this on nose cones that are made out of polystyrene plastic. Unfortunately, most high-power nose cones are not polystyrene. They're polypropylene, and polypropylene is very slick, and epoxy won't stick to it. But it will stick to our 3-inch nose cone here. So what I'm going to do is just take some epoxy clay, and I just want to take an equal glob of each side. And if they look about equal, and they look pretty close, and I'm going to mix those up, and then we're going to bond the shock cord into the nose cone. So I'm going to mix here for probably about 3 minutes. So I'll be back in just a second. Okay, so I have my epoxy mixed up. I'm then going to take my shock cord and I'm going to tie a knot into it. I just want to make sure that it gets good bonding with the epoxy. Okay, so I have a knot and I'm going to just smash that into there like that. Kind of smoosh it in there as good as I can so it makes nice contact. And then I'm going to drop it into the nose cone. You can see it's longer than the nose cone. And I'm going to take a wood dowel and smash it up into the tip. Hopefully you can see that there. You can see the dark line where the epoxy is now in the tip. And it adds a little nose weight, which is always good. Makes the rocket more stable. And then I can take my shock cord and attach a loop here. And then I trim off this excess here. And this is where I would attach another shock cord that's going to go and the parachute to the back end of the E-bay. Now, on this particular case, the question is, should I put shear pins to hold this in? And it's not a bad idea. If you're using a fiberglass nose cone, like this one right here, I would definitely put in shear pins because these things are heavier. They have a lot of inertia. And so as the rocket is going up and slowing down, the inertia of the nose cone could continue up and it would deploy prematurely. And so the shear pins would lock it in place to prevent premature ejection. But with a plastic nose cone like this, it's a little bit tighter fit because the plastic conforms better to the bulkhead and the coupler. So on one we're using paper couplers and plastic nose cones, I don't think you're going to need shear pins. It doesn't, like I said, it doesn't hurt, but you don't have to use them. We do have a video on installing shear pins if you want to see that. The other thing that you notice here is we have the switch band right here. Now, typically, we're going to need to move that switch band up to the front of the rocket. So here is the E-bay that we sell here at Apogee Components, and you can see that the switch band can be positioned anywhere along the coupler that we want. This comes pre-drilled. It's not actually drilled. It's cut with a laser for vent holes and a hole for the switch, and typically, it's right in the middle of the coupler. But it doesn't have to be there. You can move it up here, but then you still have these holes here. If you want to fill them, you can take a piece of masking tape and just go on the inside of the coupler, put the masking tape underneath the hole. Okay, so I've covered it here. And then you can take some epoxy, and I have some little excess epoxy clay, and I can push it in there, trim it off. And then when it hardens, you can sand it smooth. And so that will plug all the holes that you don't need. Then you can put this one where you want it and then just re-drill the holes for the on-off switch on your altimeter. So that's how I would do it if I was flying a rocket here like the Invicta, if I wanted to do dual deployment. The next question you might have is, what if you have a nose cone and you have the E-bay and it doesn't go in? Like, this is never going to go in. Can you still salvage that? And the answer is most likely you can. It's just going to take a little bit more work. So here I have a BT60, and we do have a BT60 eBay because there are some very small dual deployment altimeters. This one right here is called the Featherweight Blue J Plus. It's a dual deployment altimeter, and you can see there is plenty of room inside that coupler for an eBay. So again, I took the nose cone, our BT60 size nose cone, which is a PNC 41.6 millimeters. You can see, again, the coupler doesn't go in. So how do you fix that? So what I did was I took another coupler. I just hacked off a piece, and you can see I didn't even get a straight cut. But then I sliced it down the side, took out a slice, and made a coupler for the coupler. So this will slide into there like that. And now that does go into the nose cone. So this would go into the nose cone. And what I would do is I would start it out like that. I would glue it in place. Glue that coupler in place. I'd push this in as far as it would go, then push this on top of it. Wipe off any excess glue, and then reach in and then pull it out. And so that's the correct depth that it will need for the coupler. And so now this is the new eBay. This is the eBay set that we sell. That's the BT60. Comes with a tube, and it comes with all the bulkheads and the sled, which you would mount your electronics. The problem is that these bulkheads, at least on this side, are going to be too big. So you're going to need to sand them down to fit inside the coupler over here. But the one on the other side should fit just fine. So this becomes your eBay, and then you could slide in this coupler right there. And now we have head end dual deployment for a small rocket, like a BT60 size. So hopefully that tells you how you can do it. It's going to take a little bit of work, but that's what we're here for at the Apogee website, is we're here to help you. If you need help, give us a shout out. The next question you have is, how much ejection charge should I need to push out that parachute? And for that, I'm going to bring up my computer and I'll show you the other tool that we're going to need. And this one is just to find the ejection charge amount to separate the nose cone from the eBay. And I'll be right back. So the tool that I want to use to figure out how much ejection charge to put into the nose cone is RockSim. Our RockSim version 11 has a cool feature called the ejection charge calculator. So what I've done here on the screen is I've put in the Mako and I've modified it to put an eBay right up here in the nose cone. And I'll show it in 2D so you can see what I'm doing here. So here I have a parachute, and my parachute's in the wrong spot. It needs to be further forward, so I'm going to correct that first. So we have a nose cone up here. We have a parachute here. This is a 36-inch parachute, and I'm going to edit that parachute to slide it just a little bit forward into the nose cone. You can see I'm already at -4 inches, so I'm going to put it at -6 inches, maybe 7 inches into the nose cone. Yeah, that's pretty good. I'm going to, you know, it shows it as a rectangle, but actually in real life, you're going to smush it up and you're going to slide it into the nose. So this is a 36-inch parachute that comes with the Mako. Here's my nose cone, and you can see if I wrap it up really tight, there is plenty of room inside of there for the shock cord, the nose cone, and the forward end of the eBay. So that fits in there pretty nice. Plenty of room, so I'm not worried about the nose cone sticking out. And so this right here, so click OK there. This right here is a forward bulkhead. Here's the aft bulkhead. The coupler is right here. This right here is the switch band. And of course, this is the nose cone. So to use the ejection charge calculator, you come up here to rocket, you come down to ejection charge calculator, and you're going to get a side view of the rocket. So now the ejection charge calculator is set up for tubes, not necessarily a nose cone, but we can trick it. So you need to select the closest tube that's going to be pressurized. I'm going to select that one. So this tube was the original forward tube on the Mako, this tube right here. I've taken the coupler out and we're moving it forward. So to use this, what you do is you just grab the front end of this gray box right here, and this is the area that's getting pressurized. And so I'm just going to move that all the way up here to the tip of the nose cone. And then I'm going to take the back end and move it up to the bulkheads. Remember that bulkhead is right here. And this shows me a volume that needs to be pressurized. The nose cone actually has a smaller volume than a cylinder. And the formula approximately is that the volume of a cone is 1/3 the volume of a cylinder of the same length and same diameter. So basically what we can either do is divide our black powder amount by 3 or shorten the column by 2/3. So I set my desired internal pressure at 8. That's the default, and I would just leave it at that. In this case, I don't have any shear pins, but if you had a shear pins, you would put in the number of shear pins right here, and then select what diameter they are. And basically, that's all you need to do, and RockSim does the rest. It just calculates down here the amount of black powder required in grams. You can see I'm at 0.368. So I would divide that by 3 because cone is 1/3 the volume of a cylinder. So I'm at 0.124 grams. And that's how much black powder that I would need to pressurize that amount. And then on the rear of the eBay, this part back here, I would pressurize. Let me just move it around here. So here is the bottom of the eBay right there. So I'm going to be pressurizing from the base of the eBay all the way down to this bulkhead right here, because this is all open in the middle. And you just slide that over to there. And now my black powder amount is 0.447 for the back part of the rocket. So this is our apogee charge. And then the 0.124 gram amount would be for the nose cone. So it's pretty fast, pretty accurate, and makes life so much simpler when you're using a great tool like RockSim. If you'd like to know more about RockSim, or you'd like to know more about Apogee, come to our website, apogeerockets.com. When you're there, be sure to subscribe to our newsletter so you get more content like this. This is just the tip of the iceberg in the amount of content that we create every month. You'll get notification when we release new newsletters or new videos when you subscribe to our newsletter. So be sure to do that when you're on our website. My name again is Tim Van Milligan. This is the Apogee Rocketry Workshop. May the winds be light, may the skies be blue, and may all your rockets fly straight and true.